And when you know that, yeah, this person can exceed this more abundantly, you know they can exceed that. Good. You give them that respect and give them that opportunity to shine. At the end of the day, their story is incomplete without your name in it. Doing good makes one to feel good. Respecting others boosts one's confidence. You're actually selling your CV ignorantly. Why? Because everybody wants to belong somewhere. Above that, everyone wants to belong somewhere. Everyone wants to belong where they are valued. Everyone wants to belong where they are polished. Not where they are left to rot, or where they will be left or to be gathering dust. No, everyone desires where they will be watered so they can blossom. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And you know what? I really love your topic when it comes to self-respect. Just before you go out of this floor, tell us what you told me about everybody does not like to have people around them who are criminals. So if you could go through that part, just a little bit,
yeah,
before you sit down.
Already.
Thank you.
I'll tell them that how I shared it with her is that we live in a digital age where everybody wants to take selfie.
Yeah.
But if you always disrespect yourself or you're a criminal, you know, you are a con artist, nobody wants to associate with you.
That's what you told me.
Yeah.
I said you must come and tell everyone in this audience.
Yeah.
So we'd like to appreciate you. We love you. And in fact, you taught me to come up with the hashtag. When you call yourself, I'm the warrior. Go on, finish it.
Warrior princess of the universe.
Yes.
Yeah, God told me I was the warrior princess of Zion.
Yes.
No, he called me Princess of Zion. That was after I was suspended in the church. I was crying. I felt
isolated.
Deserted. He said, no. He said, Zion, you're a warrior princess. He said, you're a princess of Zion. He said, go out there and shout it from the rooftop. As time went on, I was sharing what he was teaching me. He said, you are a warrior princess of the universe. I was like, where is this one coming from? He said, no, that's an upgrade. And it can stop.
And
so he said, I'm a voice that speaks for all, the good, the bad,
the
ugly, we are all relevant.
Give a round of applause to our princess, everyone. And thank you so much for honoring us. She's going to be going to another program. She is really in demand. So I'm absolutely blessed to have you in our house today. And, you know, the reason I really love her, because she teaches her way differently.
Yeah.
In love. She has love in all written around her.
Yeah,
but when people don't, sometimes, you know, sometimes when you haven't listened, I always say to people, listen to where people are coming from.
Yeah.
Her background is she was being isolated with four children who are sickle cell. And at that time, she was finding meaning. And people did not stand to listen. And so I say to her, tell me, what are the issues? And that is how we got chatting and chatting and chatting. And I thought, what a brave woman. And you're a brave little, let me say brave cookie. And thank you for braving us. Thank you for being a warrior, because you're indeed a warrior. Give her that round of applause. Our next key speaker is going to be a teenager. We're going to have a platform just to get one of our teenager singing. Is Joelle on stage anywhere? Joelle?
Yeah.
So we're going to have a performance. And as this young youth comes in, the mother, Susan, we appreciate you. Give a round of applause to Susan as well. Kumba, she's in this house. And thank you for bringing in your son, Joelle. Joelle will tell us a little bit about himself, and do you want to be done? I think you should perform that. Yeah, thank you. Let us boost him. DJ, dance for us just for maybe a minute, please. All right. He wants to go straight into his music. Thank you. Welcome.
Thank you so much.
Hello.
Hello, hello, hello.
Yeah, so my name is Joel. I like to sing, and I like the musical theater and performing arts and everything like that. So today I was gonna sing Smile by Nat King Cole.
My God. Wow. Oh my God. Mike, he's like one of these old school.
Yeah.
No effort, just natural.
Natural.
Wow.
There's no muffin, no keyboard, no muffin.
Wow. This is Nat King Cole with Reborn.
Community leader or a coach, I would love us to mentor our teenagers, our youths. Thank you so much, Agnes, Queen of Social Media, for the work that you do to peer-to-peer support for the youth. Today is all about entrepreneurship and, of course, getting the youth and women to find their sense of purpose and, of course, as some would say, find their way towards Vision 2030. And 2063. These are our youth here today. Mommy, for Joel, we appreciate you. She reached out to me and told me that she wanted a platform for her, for this son. And I say, and why not?
Yeah.
15 years old. Can I see that round of applause for this 15 years old?
I see the gloom for me, you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people walking by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do?
Thank you. Beautiful.
Amazing. I say amazing. And you know, for me, I like it to the top. So the next time you see this, is it Britain's Got Talent?
Definitely. So
no, the voice.
A round of applause. So
the voice. That's what it does. The voice, not the talent.
The
voice.
Yeah.
Thank you. That was beautiful.
Our next key speaker is going to be talking about save your mother tongue. She's vibrant and she's very passionate when it comes to young people and the youth. Oh, thank you so much. And as Councillor Susan comes in, we welcome you. We really appreciate you. Councillor Susan Fajana. Councillor Susan is from Hackney Borough. So we appreciate you for being in the house here today, and we love you. So the next key speaker is Tanzila, and she's going to be taking us through for about 6 to 7 minutes. And her key topic that she chose here today is save your mother tongue. Thank you.
Very good evening, all lovely, wonderful gentlemen and beautiful sisters. Thank you so much for coming and giving us energy, giving us an enthusiasm to talk about all the things. Today I would like to share my own opinion.
I think that one is best.
Thank you very much, Juliet. Juliet is doing very, very hard work. She's trying to give you some amazing opportunities for youth entrepreneurs and like us, you know, to share our opinion and our personal experience and inspire other people to grow and full, you know, mental development. Especially, I am talking about the niche mother tongue. Here, I'm Tanzila Jaman. I'm a coach, women entrepreneurship. I'm doing a lot of community work. The people who knows me, they know how hard work I'm doing. Thank you so much. For my personal opinion, I would like to say that when we came in Britain, no matter how, no matter from where we came here and we have a root, we have a mother tongue. So we live here, we grow here, and we got our children as we are parents. So unconsciously, over 5 years, I worked in a community and I achieve, I actually got the awareness. Actually, very simply, unconsciously, my beautiful sisters, my beautiful parents, unconsciously, they don't teach mother tongue because they think here our children are growing up English, English environment, and all the work, all the education, everything. But yes, it's important. That's why we're here. We love Britain. We love. But who we are, rather than the passport, everybody can see who I am. Today, you can see with my appearance already who I am. It doesn't matter I have a passport or not. It matters who I am, my appearance, my culture, my tone, my color, my talking, my speech. Not British people or English. I don't care. I respect British, but I respect and love my mother tongue. So this, only this, this issue we need to think about. We need to remember who we are. Okay? So that this, we need to teach our children.
Yes.
You are British, you are privileged, but you are also rich enough in your culture, your diversity, your identity. So think about that. 20 years or 30 years before, who came here and give a lot of hard work in this country to develop. Can we respect them? Should we not respect them? We should not remember them? Yes, we need to. And this is my message to pass my all beautiful community multicultural parents. Respect them. Try to show and encourage your children how they are diverse and very rich than other people. Okay? So over 5 years I worked in the community and I faced this issue. People actually unconsciously, they don't encourage. I am not complaining and blaming. This is all about unconsciously, they don't encourage their children, the importance and significance of diversity and identity. And this is my book, Mind Your Mother Tongue. Here, this book is all my beautiful, diverse parents to encourage and guide how they can inspire and teach mother tongue in a following home. I go to library children's center and I teach, I do workshop, and the workshop is all about creative, little activity that fun and enjoy. Like one of them is like me, my son. You can see here, me and my son, we wrote this book, actually he wrote this book, all motivational and very moral story. How a parent can sit together with their child, write something. It could be poem, it could be journal, it could be story. So this book, I'm taking all the library, children's center everywhere, and I give them, show them and inspire them. So this, and also now latest version, my one of the app is coming. With a software company, they like my idea, Skill Excellence. This Excellence app will be coming January, February. And all you, my lovely sister, you is free. You can go here and you can teach mother tongue. It's Nigerian, African, Canadian, French, Spanish, whoever, Bangladeshi, English, you know, anywhere in the world. Like I have somebody here, Chinese. So Mandarin, anybody have any language, you can go through this app, it's free. You can teach, you can save your legacy. So my message, I'm not going to very prolong. The simple message, you are rich enough, your one language, one identity, but you have more, that means you are more richer than other people. So just save your legacy, save your children. Don't lose their identity, because if we don't pass it now nicely, in future, they will be feel lack of identity, and it really gives me a shaking. We need to do something, okay? So let's come together and inspire our children. Save the legacy, save mother tongue.
Right. Yay!
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Very good.
Thank you, Juliet. Thank you very much for your all kind effort.
Thank you. Isn't she amazing?
Amazing.
To remind us that we have to save our mother tongue.
They must.
Now, you know, when I asked her what topic she would like to speak about, because that's me, and we have to look at entrepreneurship, and I keep coming back to the entrepreneurship theme here today, and finding your path. You know, she has also, she's also an author, as she was speaking. Give her a round of applause for writing and finishing the book. You know, this is about our youth. And you know, when I talk about empowering our youth and inspiring our youth, that is what Garth was talking about. Absolutely human. You've challenged me as well to write my own book.
Thank you. You should, my sister. You have a lot of research to share, people.
Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone. And she was also saying to me, look out for the app.
Yeah.
Last night or day before yesterday, when I asked her to tell me about the app, she mentioned to me that the app is specifically for what they call master classes.
Yes.
And I took a lot of interest in that because I know that our key speaker here, Bernadette, was talking about profits. And we all as business entrepreneurship people need to be making money. So just a reminder, if you can do your little courses, even Bernadette, we can all have a platform now that she's done, like in for putting in the app, and we sell our topic. And that is why I'm so enthusiastic with this. Thank you so much, Antanzila.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sister.
Antanzila was also one of our media partners, so we appreciate your presence. At this stage, could we also give a round of applause to the DJ Mahama, please? Yeah. Now, at this stage, I have now got Professor Chris, who will take us through. Absolutely. You know, today is all about coaching. I've also got a key guest speaker as well, Umesh, who has just arrived. So thank you so much. Give a round of applause to Umesh, who is also a GLA candidate. He will tell us a little bit about himself. I asked him to tell us about how the GLA works. Hello, everyone, please. He will be speaking about how the platform of GLA works. And as for us, BME community, we don't really know much about how it works. So I felt it is important for us to relate to what happens in the city. We're talking about 2030, we're talking about 2063. So we're looking at policies, and it is important to understand how these places work, because it is us who will be able to champion and bring this together. My next key speaker is going to be Tarela Agati, who is the CEO of OI, and she's going to be telling us what OI means, and I will not mention it, which is a foundation in Nigeria. And today she's going to be, her topic is mental health, nutrition, and disability inclusion. We can't be talking about entrepreneurship and forget about persons with disability. So I asked her to come and support us and hear her story. Thank you so much. Give a round of applause.
Is that your number?
Thank you so much, DJ. Thank you. I'm so grateful. Yeah. I'll just quickly put on my slides so that we can work with that and we can be on track. Yeah, thank you, Juliet, for putting this amazing program together. I am Tara Aganti, and I run a charity for children and adults with critical condition. I will tell you a little bit more about that later. But this afternoon, I am going to be speaking on disability, inclusion, and also what we do in Nigeria and also in the UK here. Now, we're talking about entrepreneurship. It's not complete if you don't talk about the total well-being of an individual, of a person. Before you can go into entrepreneurship, you need to be, you know, stable and know exactly what you're doing. So yeah, I'll go to the next topic. The main topic that I'm talking about today is total well-being, mental health, inclusion, nutrition, and disability itself. So before you go into entrepreneurship, we have to consider these two main topics, which is, you know, the complete well-being of an individual, of a person, which is very important to including people that have got disability, that have got one problem or the other, into our society, how you relate with them, how you respect them. Okay, we as we go along, we see, you know, the statistics of people with mental health increasing in our society today. And if we don't do anything about it, it actually affects us and is increasing. So 1 in 8 children have been diagnosed with mental health disorder. 1 in 6 young people have been also diagnosed with mental disorder. And all this goes down to, you know, it can lead to suicide, it can lead to a lot of problems. So we really do need to talk about it, to understand it. And people with mental health or mental, you know, problems, I think for me, from my own perspective and understanding and, you know, my point of view, is we really do need to love them.
Yeah.
Because I've been in a place where, you know, because of what I've been through and the condition that my son has got, I've been in a place where people don't even understand me. People don't even understand what the condition is. And because of that trauma, is, you know, it's taking me to a place where you know, I have problems. And because people don't understand it, it just is difficult for me to even relate with others. And you know, for me, I just feel the key thing for people like that and people with disability in general, no matter what kind of disability you've got, is to love them, to understand them, to also include them in decision making. In their day-to-day life, it's very, very important that, you know, we understand and love them. So in the UK here, we've got the Mental Health Act, the 1983 Act that is also amended in 2007. That also talks about safety, mental capacity, and what decision is taken on behalf of the person. But also, you also have the Victoria Mental Health Act for the 2014. That also talks about the including a person with disability, with mental health, into their own decision making. Allow them to make decisions themselves. So it's not just about, you know, taking decisions for them, but you have to also include them. So mental health, you have different types, you know, and then you've got different things that can trigger it. So you've got mood swings or mood disorder. You've got anxiety. You've got personal disorder. We've got, you know, we've heard other key speakers speak. And when they say, they come along and say that you, who are you? You need to know yourself. You know, you need to understand yourself. We have people that have the eating disorder and trauma. So I think for me today, I'm going to be concentrating more on trauma. Trauma can actually cause, you know, somebody to have some mental problems. Yeah. I'll quickly tell you a little bit of my story. For me, I had a child with breast bone condition. And he was born with that condition. And from birth, he had 6 fractures. So he came out with 6 fractures. And when he came, he was crying all through. So we didn't know what it was. I've never heard of the word before, osteogenesis imperfecta, or, you know, AKA brittle bone condition. So for me, that brought, you know, it brought a bit of trauma to me. And I can remember one specific, you know, situation where I was just in the house, because with brittle bone condition, you know, the child tend to have, or the person tend to have constant fractures with or without any force. You can have such, you know, problems. They can just break a bone. You know, somebody with breezy bone condition can just sneeze and then have a broken bones like that. I remember wanting to wear my son a sock, and I just heard that sound, and that was the end of it. He had a fracture. So where am I driving to? At that point in time, I remember one day when my elder sister was preparing for a wedding, and we just came back from my dad's place, and I got into the house trying to just tidy the house, and the child was fine. He was just doing his own thing, and before you know it, I just heard that serious scream, the cry, and with that I tried to pick up the child, and immediately I knew it was a spine. He had a fracture on the spine. And I was so disorientated, I was so disturbed, I didn't know what to do. The only thing I could do was try and just gently drop the child on the chair, and I screamed. At that time, I was going through depression. I didn't even know that I was going through depression. So what I did was, I remember running out of the house, leaving the child, on the chair, and I ran out of my flat, ran to my neighbor's house, banged at the door. To be very honest with you, I didn't even know what I was doing. And then I ran down the stairs and went to bang on my landlord's door. And, the wife and the husband came out and said, "What's wrong with you? What's wrong? What's wrong?" All I was doing was, I was just screaming. And I was crying. I was screaming and I was crying. And when I got into the house, I held my landlord. As like, he's done something wrong to me. No, it was just the stress that I was going through, the trauma that I was passing through. I held him. And, he was asking me, "What's wrong? What's wrong?" And the next thing I remembered in my head was, "You left your child on a chair." And I ran out again, out of the house, to my son. He was screaming and crying because he had a fracture on the spine. On that day, I realized something. And it was a very fine line, a very fine line between sanity and insanity. A very, very fine line. But in all of this, we still need to love them. We still need to care for them. That day I realized that there is something called depression. Even if, unfortunately, back home in Nigeria, they don't diagnose it. No. They don't. Or they will tell you, you're suffering from witchcraft, yeah, or you're suffering from one kind of spiritual. Africans like to spiritualize, yeah, things. Yeah. And they target, they call it a name. But in all of it, we just have to love them. So care for mental health or mental health disorder. You can go through, no matter the phase that you're going through, no matter the place where you are, you can go through therapy. By profession, I'm a masseuse. So I do a lot of counseling. I do a lot of listening. And, I take my time. I've got clients where, we give them, we adapt the treatment to suit each person's needs. So I've seen from research that I've done, from practical research, from reading research, searching on the internet and all that stuff, I have seen that for mental health or for disability, for your total well-being, one thing that is very, very good is therapy. You have to listen, you have to speak to somebody. There are people out there that would love to listen to you. Now, it's not about going to speak to just anybody. You have to make sure you're speaking to the right person that is able to help you, able to listen to you, and just give you that right word that will push you on. then you can go with, you know, medication, you can go for counseling. If you're a Christian here or a Muslim, you know, you can go for prayers. You can stop, you know, you can actually talk to somebody. If the person is within your faith or you believe in prayers, you know, the person can also pray with you. I believe in prayers. I'm a Christian, so I believe in prayers. I know prayers can do wonders, but you have to back it up back with action, really. So exercise and workout, you can actually, you know, embark on that. And then balanced diet, it is very, very important. You know, if you want to have the total well-being of yourself, you have to, you know, balanced diet is very, very important. Having the right nutrition that is good for you, that will help you to improve, keeping yourself active and in good company. You need to be with people that will, you know, encourage you, not tell you, you know, I had a friend that, you know, she was on the big side. And most of her friends were like that too. And she's got some friends that are on the slim side also. But you know, one thing that really brought her down with the mental, you know, her mental state was because they were always telling her she was big. Yeah, that is the truth. But what follows after? Do you just tell that person and just leave the person and make the person, you know, whatever you tell somebody, whether you've got a message for somebody or whether you're coming from, whatever angle you're coming from, you want, it's good to say the truth to somebody, but at the same time, you have to say it in love. There is a difference in it. There is a difference when you tell somebody the truth in love, no matter how painful it is. The person will still take it nicely and then help the person. Don't just leave the person there. You can also help the person, you know, to do the right thing. So there is meditation, there is positive thinking, there is hanging out with people with the right mindset and the positive mindset that will encourage you, tell you the truth in love, just as I've explained. And then there is, you have to have good sleep. And also, vitamin D is very, very, I think even in the UK here now, they are actually promoting a lot of talks about vitamin D. It is very, very important that we be on vitamin D, especially for people with dark skin. It is very, very important. You know, your vitamins will keep you really going. Now, with people with disability and people with mental, you know, health issues, I personally recommend one of the good remedies that you can have is massage. Not because I'm a masseuse, but you know, it is something that I've researched myself and I have done myself. So it is very, very good to actually, you know, give that or receive massage as most times as possible. I'll tell you, I know it's my line of profession, but do you know what massage does to you? Okay. We're going to take a scenario now. A very simple one, really. Number one, it depends on the type of, you know, treatment that you're having. You're going to be in a calm environment. Massage helps you to really, like, you know, increase the blood flow of your body. So if you're having high blood pressure, you need to be very careful. But if you want to be stable, you want to be calm, a relaxed mode and a relaxed place, you know, you just want to have that elforage that just goes through you. Because it will help to increase the stability of the blood in the brain that flows to the brain, and the part of your body, especially if you're having something like Indian head, the part of your body that, you know, that works with it, your muscles, your tendons, they are all connected together from the brain all the way down to your feet. So when you have this massage, it actually relaxes the body, not just the body, it relaxes the mind. it also relaxes the muscles in your body. So that helps you to be able to think. It helps you to be able to relax, to move on. And in the process of having your massage, even before your massage, you can have a consultation. And then I've got, you know, real life, when I have my clients, there is time for consultation. It might be 5 minutes, and sometimes from people with 5 minutes, it can go up to, depending on what problem, you know, it's all adapted to what suits the need of that individual. But I'm concentrating on this more because I know, if you research it more, organizations are actually leaning up onto that side, that area, where they want, because they want to increase their productivity, the productivity of the workers in the organization. There are times that where they employ masseuse to come in and then give some relaxation, not a full body, because then you know it's an open place, maybe like a hand massage, like a shoulder massage to keep them calm and relaxed so that they can produce more. Organizations are actually doing it today. That is the well-being that they are looking after of their workers. It helps to relax the muscles, it helps to relax the brain, and it helps to relax, you know, and improve functionability of an individual. So yes, I was talking about, pardon me, I was talking about balanced diet and vitamin D. The vitamin D is very, very important, as I said, for people with dark skin. Because in this country, we really do not have sunshine. So, and then with our dark skin again, the little that comes off, that comes, you know, through, it's difficult for our skin to even absorb it. So you need to really be on the vitamin D because it helps to balance your system. And then you've got the vitamin B12. Vitamin, especially for women, vitamin B12 is very, very important. I'll leave you to do that homework yourself. Just Google it and just see. You know, you will see the importance of vitamin D and the omega-3. It helps, you know, with the function of the brains, of the brain also. So and you know the vitamin D, you know, even my son that has got a bristle bone condition. I remember the doctor always hammering on it. You have to be, Steven, you have to be on your vitamin D. You have to be on your vitamin D. Recently, we just really broke it down for us to really understand what the vitamin D is all about. And it is very, very good for people that are, you know, you want to be relaxed, people with mental health problems, people with bone issues, people with, as you're growing as an individual, you need to, you know, be on that to help you, you know, your body system and your body immunes to be really strong so that then you can also fight immunity and you can also fight infections and all that stuff. It does help a lot. So for you to really, you know, if you're going into entrepreneurship and the life skill of, you know, of life in general, you need to be on top of you know, the well-being of your own personal self. Because if you don't look after yourself, honestly, there's nobody that will look after you. You need to be you. You need to look after yourself first. I've got a son with disability, and I've got a family. I've got two other children. I've got a husband. But I keep telling them, some of my friends say, Carella, you're too selfish. I said, yes, you can say that. But if I'm not selfish, the way you're saying it, you allowed your own opinion. But to be very honest with you, I need to look after myself first. Because if I don't look after myself, if I'm not able to be strong, if I'm not strong, there is absolutely no way I can look after somebody else. So we're talking about self-respect here. We're talking about self-love. It's what you have that you give out. If you don't have health, you can't give. You can't help somebody to have health. If I don't have health, there is no way I can help somebody, you know, I can be a good masseuse to help somebody to heal from things that are happening with them, you know, giving them a good massage and, you know, listening to their problems, because it's going to weigh me down. It's going to give me more problems. So I need to be selfish to look after my own self. But in a way, I don't see that as being selfish, because if you nice selfish. It's a nice one. So yeah, you really do need to look after yourself. And you know, eat the right fruits, eat the right kind of food that will help you to be healthy, and you know, you can then produce more. You can be yourself and then produce more. So the importance of you being yourself and producing more, being a good entrepreneurship, you know, it will increase growth in what you do. You can also, with that, you can create jobs for other people. Innovation. Then you can impact on other people, not just other people, but your whole community. Just being yourself. Yeah, it keeps you busy. It enhances mental stability. Yeah, I'm just gonna name a few. Then self-development, confidence is also increases your confidence. You know, because I know people with disability, one of the problems that they go through, you know, is they lack that confidence. It still boils down to who are you? Are you confident in your own skin? Are you confident in your own self? What are your fears that you have to deal with? You know? There are many such skills, but core life skills includes ability to focus and have self-control, positive thinking, making connections, and critical thinking. So if until you have that, until you're calm in yourself, until you have your own self, you know yourself, that is when you're actually able to give that out. You know, that you can think properly, you can have, you know, self-awareness, you can just be yourself. And in the process of, you know, with all that, you can make informed decisions. You can make proper decisions that will help you to move on with your entrepreneurship and also move on with yourself in life. With all that, you can also say, yeah, you want to look inward. What do you have inside? You know, like the princess was talking, it's what you have that you give out. If you don't have anything, you can't give out anything. If you don't have love, you can't give out love. If you don't have patience, you can't give out patience. So it's what you have inside. You have to look at your inside. So with me today, I have actually tagged this word, the 5 W's. So you look inward. Passionate about in your total well-being next, what are you passionate about? What do you want to give out? What are you good at? What do you like doing? What are the needs that you want to meet? And when can you start? So you need to actually ask yourself all that before you go into what you want to do. Where are you at the moment? No matter where you are, you have to really look inward and be, you know, be strong in yourself. I think this is just going to come out as an encouragement. You know, you want to be strong in yourself. You want to know who you are. It doesn't matter where you are. It is what you do at that point where you are that matters. If you say, oh, okay, for example, now I've got a son with disability and he cannot walk, he's wheelchair bound. If I say, oh no, I've got a child with disability, I cannot be strong in myself, nobody is going to do anything for me. But I have to find that strength inside of me to push on. It's what I do with the situation that I find myself in that matters, not where or the situation that I find myself. So yeah, I'm just going to, I think Juliet is on me right now, so yeah, I'm just gonna slide through. So with the disability, I'm gonna concentrate more on OI because I can talk about other disability, but more on OI.
What is O-I? What is osteogenesis? It's called osteogenesis imperfecta. I know it's jaw-breaking, and you can just simply say it is brittle bone condition. So brittle bone condition is generally just known as is a condition that, you know, the genes of it is in the genes of an individual. It is whereby the collagen of an individual is either not enough, or the child is not enough, or not there at all. So when it is a default, it's a different. So when the child has been born, then the child comes out with a brittle bone condition. So yeah. So I've had my son now for his 16 years, and he was born in Nigeria. And I remember when he was born, a lot of people told me, oh, this is witchcraft tree, this is a lot of stuff, you know, spiritualism and all that. But, you know, fortunately, I was very fortunate I brought my son to the UK for treatment. So he's had 4 surgeries, and hopefully he wouldn't have any more. But the doctors are looking at another one. About 4 rods have been put in his legs at the moment. So he's wheelchair bound, he's 16, and he's had more than 100 fractures already in his lifetime. And we just love him, and we just accept that this is our faith, this is where we are, and we just move on with that. So yes, I decided to, you know, because we didn't know what it was, I decided to go back to Nigeria 3 years ago to start off a foundation to support other children, because we thought that to be, you know, if I'm fortunate to come here, a lot of people will be in Nigeria or back home that wouldn't even understand what it is. And then they will still be bullied, they will still be, you know, isolated, they will not be included into society, they will still be, you know, demonized, and, you know, just shoved, you know, to a place. So I decided to go back home and start the organization. So quickly, what does the organization do? We encourage people with people suffering from osteogenesis imperfecta, principal condition, and then the organization that itself actually provide medication for these children, because there is no cure for principal condition as at the moment, but I can tell you that there's a lot of research going on to find a cure. But at this moment in time, there is no cure. So you can only be on medication and have corrective surgeries, because with osteogenesis imperfecta, it comes with a lot of deformity. So to correct that, we have to go through, the children or the adults have to go through surgery. So the organization actually provide bisphosphonate medication to these children, and then we give it to the doctors in Nigeria, and they administer it. And we also, what we do is we connect our doctors in Nigeria and connect the doctors here to support us, because Nigeria is a third world country. We're just developing, and because this condition is not well known in Nigeria, so we are still raising awareness in it. Even in the UK, it's still a rare condition. So we are raising a lot of awareness in the UK here also, and outside the UK, to, you know, for people to understand what brittle bone is and all that stuff. So yeah, we provide them with medical equipment to help them to be comfortable, you know, wherever they are. They can be independent, and then we try to promote inclusion. And at the same time, even with the organization, we try to mentor people, we try to speak to people, we try to speak to our members. You know, the total well-being of the parent, of the carer, is more important, so that they can also look after their own children. So yeah, I'm going to end up with this note. So yeah, but what I would like to say finally is, I know we all, you know, we are all in different stages in life. Your total well-being of yourself is very, very important. You look after yourself, it doesn't matter where you are. What matters is, what do you do with that situation where you are? Do you give up, or do you fight on? Do you move on? Or you just want to say, oh no, I'm fed up, I am tired, I'm sick, I'm just going to give it up. No, never give up. You're all fighters. It is in you. That situation has actually come to bring out the best in you. So take
change with the person. You know, sometimes these days I change it around. So for those who she was not able to introduce herself, but I will say she's a self-motivated and resourceful professional with excellent performance record in what she does in her profession in the world of OI and disability inclusion. Tarella is so passionate in helping people get relaxed through therapy, and she's passionate about raising OI. Can someone tell me what OI means? They've been listening to it. You can hear. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So, supporting people living with brittle bones condition and disability. She's also an advocate in this course from September 19, 2019, and she received a corporate social responsibility CSR award. Give her a round of applause for her. Tarella is also a manager at Tranquility Spa and the founder of and CEO of Osteogenesis Imperfecta Foundation in Nigeria, married to Victor Aganti and a proud mother of three beautiful children, 18, 16, and 8 years of age, respectively. She is a Christian by faith and lives in the UK with her family. Her mission statement is making a change in our time, supporting people living with brittle bone conditions, OI, and disability as a whole, helping them find their voice to live a complete and total whole body well-being life through therapy. We really appreciate you.
Thank you so much.
And you know, when I asked her to come and speak to us, we're all getting, you know, we are, as we grow, we get elderly. And I thought about the well-being of entrepreneurship, and I felt that we needed to be thinking about wellness and being and our own mental health. So I asked her to come in, and she came in, and thank you for helping us as well to market and to volunteer. We love you, and let's give her a support all the way in Nigeria. Thank you. And in-house here today, I have a wonderful friend who helped me to book this place. Give a round of applause to Clyde Lewis, who helped me to book this place. Without his deposit, I would not be able to put this place up. So again, a round of applause for our wonderful Mr. Clyde Lewis, who is also an engineer. We appreciate your presence. We thank you for being here with us. We thank you for blessing us and for being kind and looking into the future with us. So I really am grateful. Bringing to the stage right now is a wonderful mayor and also a councillor. A few days ago, I was invited into Tower of Hamlets. She did a beautiful function for Black History Month. This is October month, and October month is celebrated across United Kingdom. And I would love to appreciate the mayor of, civics mayor of Tower of Hamlets, Victoria Obaze. As she walks in, please give us a councillor of Tower of Hamlets in Whitechapel. Give us a round of applause.